thank you all so much for coming. I thought I was done with like super, super hot classrooms for the day once the weather broke, and then I stepped in here and I felt at home. This is just like that. My name is Catherine Coles. I'm the director of the Trias Writer's Residency, and I want to thank you all for coming out tonight. This is a great crowd. I have, because this is the first reading, I have lots of people to thank. I'm going to a wave of thank yous. Thank you to the Provost's Office, particularly to Provost Ucramato, who hosted a reception earlier tonight from Mary. Thanks to the English Department, to the Art and Architecture Department, to Asian Studies, all of which are helping to co-sponsor various events in the Trias Reading Series this semester. And as always, most especially to Peter Trias, our patron saint, of the reading series. This is, if you don't know about Trias, this is something that not a lot of undergraduate programs have, and that we have that is astonishing, that is amazing, that we have this capacity to bring out a world-class writer every fall semester to work with a group of students and teach them, people who teach the best graduate students in the country. And then we have this associated reading series where you get wonderful friends and colleagues of that writer in residence coming out over the course of fall and spring semester. And this is all because of Peter Trias, an alum, right? The Peter Trias Endowed Fund for Poetry and Creative Writing. Someone who graduated from Hobart gave a bunch of money to us so that we could establish this and so we could have this extraordinary program. We're very lucky to have this. Coming up this semester in our excellent reading series curated by Mary Ruefle, our writer in residence, is on October 29th. We have like a double header. We have David Hinton, a translator from the Chinese, really, really probably the most important translator into English from Chinese around ever. He's wonderful. I've been reading his work since graduate school. That's October 29th at 5 p.m. And I believe he's also a wonderful poet and essayist. And I believe he's going to be reading a smattering of different things in a kind of a multimedia presentation. That will be wonderful. Then we'll have a little reception at Comstock in between. And then we'll have the second game, which is the poet, hybrid forms artist, and translator from French, Jody Gladden, who is also completely wonderful. And that will be at 7:30 also in Hirshson. So it'll be a little bit of a marathon of events, but all wonderful, wonderful, exciting things. A kind of a thrilling day set up there. On November 19th, we're going to have the wonderful poet and HWS alum, Michael Burkhard, come and read for us, who I have been told has wonderful stories about his time at HWS, including an epiphany in the library back when Blackwell was the library. You can imagine having a poetic epiphany in that space with the giant stained glass windows. So you might hear about that. And that's our Trias Reading Series for the fall semester. We also have a former Trias writer-in-residence, our very first one, Tom Piazza, who is so completely beloved on campus, is coming back for a reading on September 30th. He's having a book released on September 15th called A Free State, and we are lucky enough to have him come and read. He'll be reading here at 7:30 on September 30th. So lots of really cool events coming up that I hope you'll attend. You'll hear more about them via email. And I know you all read all of the emails you get very, very carefully. Very many people who send them. I want to give a really, really big shout out to Joshua Unicol, who designed our gorgeous chapel. Joshua is another HWS alum who has multiple MFAs in like things that help him to be the perfect person to design this chapel. So his graphic design and creative writing, and he's just a wonderful, amazing designer, and we're so, so lucky to have him working with us on all of these Trias chapels. Thank you, Joshua, and to David for putting so much work always in producing, David Weiss, in producing the chapbooks every year. And to Mary for writing the extraordinary poems that go into the chapbook. And thanks to Brian for selling books for us. Of course, there are lots of books available. They make wonderful presents for friends and family members. You can get them signed after the reading. And thank you to Sue Gage, without whom everything would fall apart. And most of you probably wouldn't even know to be here. She makes these things possible and is so wonderful that I run out of words to say how wonderful she is. So, Mary Ruefle is not a great fan of introductions, so I'm going to skip over the usual litany of grand accolades and praises, but I do want to let most especially the students in the audience know a bit about why we chose Mary to be the 2015-16 Trias Writer in Residence, why we are and why I am so very enamored of her and her work. And I'm going to keep this to 10 sentences describing things that I've noticed about Mary's poems and essays and erasures and other works that make me want her to teach my students and also to write books so that I can read them. One, Mary's poems sometimes find their own secret doors and go through them into whole other poems, or maybe they get threaded through the holes of their own needles and then stitched. Two, sometimes the figurative slips into the literal in Mary's writing. Metaphors turn into the actual stuff of the world, so that if something wasn't literal to begin with, sometimes all you have to do is outweigh it. Three, some of the poems and essays feel like Mobius strips that come full circle only after facing for quite some time in a completely other direction. Four, sometimes when reading Mary's writing, you feel like you are leaping from one seemingly unrelated image to the next non sequitur until you discover you've been leaping in an order on a path of leap stones across something. Five, sometimes I don't know what a particular line means, except that I really do deep down know what it means, in the sense that one knows what it means to say something like, quote, more snow fell than was able to melt, or, quote, you have produced enough tears to fill to 1/8 of an inch of the top, Lake Bipel, and now someone would like to swim. Six, sometimes I laugh out loud when I'm reading Mary's writing. Seven, sometimes I laugh out loud early on and then I stop and really actually weep, surprised for a minute, 3/4 of the way through, and then sometimes I laugh again at the end. Eight, sometimes I lose track of scale such that the everyday looks the same to me as the very grand, and the very big starts to look like the very small, and the very old starts to resemble the very young. Nine, when I read Mary's writing, I often get the sense that it hasn't figured out where it's going before it gets there, and I really, really, really like it, and feel as though it, the writing, and I are adventuring together, although actually I'm probably just tagging along. 10. Sometimes with Mary's writing, a story or a word or a phrase or an image, this is kind of a long sentence, so I'm really pushing the 10 sentence thing here. Sometimes with Mary's writing, a story or a word or a phrase or an image will come up and I'll get the feeling that it's packing its suitcase, getting ready to carry the contents over some great distance. And then much later in the same piece, when I've forgotten all about the story or the word or the phrase or the image, it suddenly gets off the plane right in front of me and I remember what's in its suitcase and I realize how far I must have traveled to get to it or how far it must have traveled to get to me that way. It is a great pleasure to be able to welcome and introduce to you our wonderful Trias Writer in Residence, Mary Ruefle.
I wanted to begin, as I often do, with a quotation by another poet, but I left it in my home, and I have a horrible memory. So, a rough paraphrase, it's by Antonio Machado, is, I dreamt last night there was a beehive in my heart, and the bees were making sweet honey and white combs from all my mistakes and failures. Something like that. We take gratitude for granted. And we never should. I'm thankful for the bees. And I'm thankful for Peter Trias. As a writer, I spend my life being thankful to the dead. I'm thankful for two people tonight, and one is Peter Trias and the other is Deborah Tall. I didn't know Peter Trias, but I've never been able to afford to own a home, and I'm living in a beautiful home, thanks to him, surrounded by his books and artifacts. And Deborah Tall brought me to this campus many, many years ago. I gave a reading. I don't even remember how many years ago. And published some of my early prose in the Seneca Review and introduced me to David. And I'm sure if it were not for Deborah, I would not be standing here. So, gratitude always to the dead, and gratitude always to the living, and also to the creatures such as the bees. And everyone here is so nice. Scary. I'm going to read both poems and prose. I will not stop to differentiate, because life's too short. American Mouse. I'm too lazy for a 9-to-5 job, so I call myself an artist. The truth is, I sit around smoking and think about Plato. Sent to the monk. Night falls, and the empty intimacy of the whole world fills my heart to frothing. The past has trudged to this one spot with a flashlight in its mouth and falls into the stream. Ancient tears beneath the surface rise and scatter like carp, while an ivory hairpin floats away like a loose tooth going back in time. July 23rd. I was many times experienced by snow. Now the new days are here, full of sticky red tape that keeps the bee on the head of the coneflower and a jubilant, expansive baby who always understands everything. Far out at sea, the wave of waves is barely beginning to swell, moving steadily inwards as it gains an arithmetical momentum which will not cease until the wave of waves, like all waves and other waves, can be counted, this time 112,048. Unbeknownst. Words have no thoughts, just as you have no lice. And yet, our might is often present and never seems by word or look to disapprove of us. Can he draw the line between paper and all the brain-sickening effluvia of reading? Words you may find as you read, you may find as you read, you deepen them. Until tomorrow, you can describe the unprepared head growing and winding about in wild entanglement within the little coffin, ever where there is no to be. Just as if in English. I'm in a foreign country and don't understand a word. Yet I know I understand what they're saying. It's hot, I'm tired, shall we have a glass? One of the bridges is glass-bottomed, and lovers come to that one to put padlocks on the railing, signifying an everlasting tryst. This, too, I understand, though it makes no sense to me. How many bridges are there? I mean inside each one of us. From the sound of a pencil sharpener to someone applying mascara. From a place we understand to a place we never will. The Heart of Princess Osra. I want to slow down and reflect, like the top waters of a lake, or the heart of Princess Osra, who had 9 suitors at one time. I want to thank my clothes for protecting my body. I want to fold them properly. I want the energy that flows from my hands to engulf the world. Upon reflection, this is not possible. Upon reflection, it is I who am pummeled by the world, that vast massage machine. And so is the sheen of many waters. And Princess Osra surely too was pummeled by the world, which is so full of hands and clothes. The same is true, I think, for babies. Jewelweed. Mother and daughter spend the summer popping jewelweed pods. A sensitive plant, its pods explode at the slightest touch. A train passes on the other side of the river. Little girls in the water frantically wave their teenage dolls. A woman on a towel rolls over. Hope is in a napkin buried in the earth like salt. Mother and daughter touch another pod, and the lifeguard's whistle warns the boys not to jump from the bridge. A single cattail holds more energy than a ton of coal. And at night, the stars ask the day if things aren't other than they seem. Tuna and a play. Tonight we are having tuna and a play. Earlier I picked grasses with Jay. Blue grass, pink grass, silver grass, we each carried a bouquet. I asked Jay if she was glad to be human. Jay, are you glad to be a human? But she couldn't say. She walked through the grasses for what seemed like a day. I thought I saw her face turn gray, but it was no more than a moment in a very nice day. And tonight, we are having tuna and a play. Does it, by any chance in the farthest reaches of the universe, happen to be anyone's birthday? It doesn't surprise me, because anyone that would go to a poetry reading on their birthday is out of their mind. But fortunately or unfortunately, I will not read that. I only read it. It's written for someone whose birthday it is, so.
Can you come back tomorrow?
Is it your birthday tomorrow? Maria and the Halls of Parrish. She loved dandelions, but hated the circus. She wanted to know where eggs came from, really came from. Where came the body of the body of the body they came from? And when her heart made that sad little oboe note, she wanted to know where the mind came from. and was as answerless as if she sat in the middle of a beginningless river. Rock, explosion, dust, light. Reminded her of the time the toy factory blew up, and she found a little clown on the shore, and then another, until she was determined to find them all, the whole shebang. Though she never did, and night fell over the ocean, and eye-popping children of all ages slept in a sleep brimming with irresistible attractions, giving them a taste of what awaited them when they awoke, though it was nothing compared to the massive arrays of adulthood. Cracker Bell. I grew up. I became myself and was haunted by it. And I love to wander, utterly alone, listening to the sound of tears, striving to guess my own secret and racking my imagination for a dream. Meanwhile, everybody else knew my story, and there was not one of them who would give me so much as a bird dropping. So on I wandered with arms and electric startled eyes, nitpicking my way through the world, when the electrical current that runs in all directions deep beneath the earth shook me. And at once I felt there are so many years to fail, that to fail them all, one by one, would give me a double life, and I took it. Who knew? Nothing doing except today, and the ice in the trees bringing the stars to earth, and a candle crafted for my own personal pleasure by nice people in Wingate, North Carolina, who had another brilliant idea, adding nuts to soap. How did they know life escapes philosophy in a little bag of protoplasm? That it is possible for a revolutionary to love flowers. For an hour, I read about another's childhood, and so long sequestered, outpoured the old strangely remembered, every fat particle of it able to transmit an odor. I tried to make new the never-ceasing cry of the mouth, and my friend sat with her hands in her lap so I could study them. Every creature in divine sleep begins to dream of obscure love. So be not afraid of horses reading in the moonlight. Be not afraid of people you see in the street. Each carries a cloud whose weight is distributed among us. Boutonniere. I picked a Cheerio up off the floor. I read Rudyard Kipling, then listened to the Beach Boys. I glanced at a drawing by someone I know only slightly, then wrote a postcard saying, I love you. She won't even know who it's from. I don't know where this day came from, but the Lord of Lies and Panic has fled. Fluttering people sit quietly upon their horses. And anon one enters with a broom, making ready the place. These are all new poems that I'm reading. My habit not to read from anything that's been published in a book, although some of these have been in magazines or whatever. And just so you know, they're all true to life. Even though they don't sound like it, they actually happen. Like this one. Actually, I don't really write my poems, but because people say things and do things, and I just put them in my poems. So I'll go ahead and tell you that the best part of this poem I didn't write. See, this poem is just a true story as it happened. It was about a little note that the poet June Valentine left for me. It's called The Note. The little green note you left by the soap after the room was empty, I took it. Go to Greenland. Go straight to the boat. Do not even stop to get coffee. When you see the icebergs, say hi. Everything is going to be fine. Chain of flowers. In the way, in the world, here and there, more and more, some of them, some of us, hand in hand, ought to know, that is to say, at a loss, for the first time. If that sounds like shorthand for something, it is. My mother knew shorthand. She is dead, as is everyone who ever learned that language. I am speaking it now like a chain of flowers. It connects us every time we speak. A restless desire propels us forward in broad swipes, hand to hand. That is to say, the search for lost speech, this ink so rich and black, goes on. The rest of this really does have a right flush margin. That stuff was lineated, this has a right flush margin. Lucky. While I was sleeping, God broke into my heart and nailed up pictures of himself in different clothes. He asked me which one I liked the best, but it was apparent I was to like them all. I didn't like any of them, but there was one, a white robe with a floating blue halo above the neckline where his face should be, and I thought to that picture I could at least express my fear. So I said I liked it. Immediately he said that I had no taste. I thought I would wait then and there with a bad taste in my mouth and choose for the day brightly colored clothes of the kind I would never wear, but that didn't happen. I slept dreamless as a baby, and when I awoke, I was naked as a baby, and alone, and afraid. The gift. The day the living room flooded, I had not left the apartment in 5 days. Everything was spotlessly clean. I had no work to do except writing my thoughts in a journal, the thought of which filled me with terror and boredom. That fateful and final morning, I was in bed reading, unable to concentrate because of what I had done the day before. The day before, I had ordered by telephone a large gift box of glossy apricots from Australia. The catalog, South Sea Gifts, showed the fruit in a handsome wooden crate lined with gold foil. They cost $86.20, and I had them sent to myself with a gift card that said, "For Mary, to Mary." I was uneasy because I now had no money to buy groceries with, and it would be some time before the apricots arrived, even though I had sent them express, which costs more. I looked forward to them arriving, but at the same time, they would, when they arrived, only remind me of my stupidity and terrible guilt. My guilt was tremendous. To have used the last of my money sending myself a gift of glossy apricots. And the gold foil, that had cost more too. The cheaper home boxes had more apricots in them, but were without gold foil. The gold foil looked so nice shining beside the golden apricots. Of course I had been looking at a photograph, and I worried that the picture was somehow touched up, because I once met a food stylist whose job it was to make photographs of food look better than the food itself. She used glycerin and starch and hairspray to make things luscious and shiny, crisp, fresh, mouth-watering in a tantalizing way. I didn't want to open the box and be disappointed. I also thought of ordering a circle of white cotton mosquito netting, but came to my senses. At least I could eat the apricots. What would I do with mosquito netting? I just like the way it looks. You can drape it over anything, and the drape thing becomes soft and mysterious. I read an article once about a woman who was an intensely intellectual Buddhist, and she wanted to make her house as empty and white as possible, but she owned thousands of books, which dragged the energy of the space down. So she simply made vertical pillars of her books and draped netting over them and got the effect she was after. The effect of owning nothing, wanting nothing, living in a windswept environment of peace. All my extravagant mail ordering, it had me feeling uneasy. I felt vapid and shallow and guilty. I loved my books, and just the sight of them strewn around on low-lying tables and lined up on windowsills and stacked on the floor, along with catalogs and unopened bills, had always made me feel happy in a teeming, chaotic way, and gave me the feeling my life was full and interesting, that I was a serious and charming person. I also worried about the people who answered the phone for the catalog companies. Did they have enough to eat? Did they ever steal a glacé apricot or two? I knew they had work. They had to answer phone calls. They had to calm the caller down and answer all her questions. They had to explain the difference between a gift box and a home box. I could see them in a cavernous room, sitting in makeshift booths with earphones on. For some reason, I draped them all with mosquito netting. I mean, each one individually wore a cocoon of soft white gauze. It muffled their voices while they spoke to the customer. She had to ask them to repeat what they just said. So an endless loop of repetition began to bubble up from the cocoons. That's how I pictured it. It was then I heard the water in the living room bubbling up from some mysterious source. I got out of bed to investigate, and as soon as I entered the hall, I saw a pool of brown water advancing towards my feet. I had forgotten to put my slippers on. I was standing on my bare feet, and the brown water came on over my ankles. I waded forward toward the living room. The sofa was covered with mud and pieces of debris, sticks and clumps of leaves, the black gunk that closes off a rain gutter. There was a high water mark on the television screen, a wavy white salt horizon that crossed the black glass. My books, too, were covered with the wavy lines of loose, disintegrating matter. Detritus, I believe it is called. Some piglets were scavenging the place, eating the stuffing out of a chair in the corner, a chair I always read in. Why did I decide to read in bed that morning? I don't know. It was highly unusual. Everything was waterlogged. The legs of the table looked soft, like they were made of oatmeal, and a mass variety of spiders swarmed on top of my table, the way I've seen ants swarm under my welcome mat outside. The flood had obviously subsided. It must have happened during the night when I was sleeping. I thought for a moment there was a bloated corpse on the floor, but it was just a sack of rotten potatoes that had floated out from under the sink and was stranded in the stagnant water, a gelatinous mass, puffed up and green. I'm ashamed to say my first thought was that I could not possibly clean up this mess by myself. I needed help. And what about those piglets in the corner devouring my chair? Where did they come from? The place stank. It smelled worse than a sewer. It smelled like a petri dish of primordial ooze, and whoever I called for help would have to cordon off more than my living room. The entire building and the block it sat upon would have to be cordoned off, too. And in this way, another day of potential reverie had been broken into. Utterly destroyed by my desire for an apricot, a single indiscretion for which my habitat had become a village of sticks on the banks of a rising river where trade winds blew and the rains came and mosquitoes bred, and where mosquitoes breed, one will be needing some netting. Observations on the ground. The planet seen from extremely close up is called the ground. The ground can be made loose by the human hand or by using a small tool held in the human hand, such as a spade, or an even larger tool, such as a shovel, or a variety of machines commonly called heavy equipment. We bury our dead in the ground. Roughly half of the dead are buried in boxes, and half of the dead are buried without boxes. A burying box is an emblem of respect for the dead. We are the only species to so envelop our dead. An earlier, more minimal way to envelop the dead was to wrap them in cloth. Besides burying the dead in the ground, we bury our garbage, also called trash. Man-made mountains of garbage are pushed together using heavy equipment and then pushed down into the ground. The site of this burial is called a landfill. The site of the dead buried in boxes is called a cemetery. In both cases, the ground is being filled. A dead body in a box can be lowered into the ground using heavy equipment, but we do not consider it trash. When the dead are not in boxes, and there is a man-made mountain of them, we use heavy equipment to bury them together, like trash. It is estimated that everywhere we walk, we are walking on a piece of trash and the hard and soluble remains of the dead. Whatever the case, the dead and the garbage are together in the ground where we cannot see them, for we do not relish the sight or smell of them. If we did not go about our burying, we would be in danger of being overcome. Also buried in the ground are seeds, which we want to see when they emerge from the ground in their later form, that is, as plants. Plants rising from the ground are essential to life. To bury a seed is to plant it. When a seed is planted and not seen again, those who buried it are made sad. The anticipated plant of the wished-upon seed has not materialized. It is dead and remains buried. Heavy equipment is used to plant large expanses of ground with seed. When a whole field of shivering grain rises from the earth, there's a growing sense of happiness among those who buried it. Happiness is also present when a tree emerges, or a tree that will bear fruit or leafy green edible plants that were formerly planted. When flowers arise from the ground, colorful and shapely in an astonishing variety of ways, the living are made especially happy. Not only are flowers admired for their outward beauty of form, their scents are capable of overcoming us and therefore prized. Nothing, it seems, makes the living as happy as a flower. Flowers are among the most anticipated things on earth. For this reason, we separate the flower from the ground and present it to another to hold or to look at. After a while, the flower which has been separated from the ground dies, and we throw it in the trash. Flowers are often planted where the dead are buried in boxes, but these flowers are never cut. That would be horrible. Whoever did such a thing would be considered a thief. Those flowers belong to the dead. Inky flourish. More than 100 years after his death, it was found that a manuscript by Charles Baudelaire, upon close inspection, bore not just an inky flourish between poems, the way today's poet might type an asterisk between paragraphs, but that each inky flourish was, in fact, a floating swan, an aquanaut of gracefully curving neck and carefully upturned tail feathers. And it was following this discovery that a later manuscript was examined and, upon closer inspection, was clearly seen not to contain not just an inky flourish between poems, but floating cell phones, the Starship Enterprise, and American hot dogs in white buns with a caterpillar of yellow mustard slinking lengthwise along the dog. But none of these things had been invented, was the cry of the critic. Ah, Charles Baudelaire, the visionary, who once said, "Paris may change, my melancholy is fast. You have crawled from the depth of antiquity by means of your own inky flourish straight into the heart of our present-day turmoil. What say you now, Charlie?
The sublime.
Had no warning of what to expect, no sign of sharp curves. Hadn't gone far when I came to hairpin turns every few hundred feet. On both sides of me, deep canyons with only a few skimpy bushes between me and the abyss. My hair stood on end. The road was narrower and narrower, turning this way and that as I climbed, hunched over the steering wheel. Could see from the corner of my eye that there was an incredible view, but couldn't look. A strange thing. Maybe I read this or dreamt it, for my mind wanders as I age. But I have always believed Odysseus, when he heard the sirens, was hearing the Odyssey being sung. And in fear of being seduced by his own story, he had himself bound. And he was in even greater fear of hearing the end, for he could not bear the possibility he might become someone other than who he was now, a war hero of great courage and unexcelled strategy, trembling against the cords of his own mass. Or he might become an even greater man, one without a single fear in the world, one who would balk at a man having to tie himself up in fear of anything. And then it would be revealed that the man he was now was actually a coward. Either way, he felt doomed as he sailed past his own story. He sailed past the island. He sailed past the sirens just as they were coming to the end. And once out of earshot, he did a strange thing, of which there is no record, the story having ended in some faraway sound which was no more distinguishable than an eyedropper of sweetness in the vast and salty sea. Thank you for coming out tonight and listening. Thanks, and I'd be happy to sign books or answer questions. Answer questions publicly right here at a microphone. This is how it's done, and I don't mind one bit. So, ask away. Yeah, David.
Yeah, is there a reason why you ended the reading with the C's?
Oh, you made a nice ending. I should have said, you know, most people go, and this is the last one, or they go, three more. I don't know. I just, it's kind of new. I just thought it made more sense, but that was my impulse. Yeah, I just, whatever. Come on. My students are not shy, and if they're not shy, of course they're not here, but if they were, they would know. Yes.
I'm of course intrigued by the fact that you said that your poems are all true. I'm sure that you have more to say on what that means about your poem. But I was going to ask you to tell us about the Baudelaire poem.
Oh, okay.
Because there's a passage there that, in the way I use the word, doesn't seem like.
Oh, I see. Well, okay. Obviously, you know, I made that up. They have not looked at these inky flourishes under a microscope or anything. But, I had, you know, that piece is not
it's not new. I don't remember anything about writing it. It just kind of popped in my head. No, I make up things, obviously. You can tell, you know, when they're made up. But in the poems, that was a prose piece, but in the poems, there's a detail that comes from everyday life. I mean, I don't just sit down and start writing a poem. I'm too lazy. I have to see or hear something. You know, I could be in my car going to the dump, and I see something amazing, and then I start writing a poem, or language gets looping in my head. So they are based on details from my everyday life, although a large part of my everyday life is my imagination. There's a great deal of imagination in the work, but oftentimes, for instance, I'll give you a few examples. I usually don't do this, but you know, just concrete examples. I read a poem called Chain of Flowers, In the Way, In the World, In the Mirror. That's a literal translation of shorthand phrases. In shorthand, there's not strokes for every letter. It's a language that secretaries use in taking dictation before there were other means. There are certain swipes, strokes in shorthand that stand for phrases, and that's a list of phrases for which there are equivalent strokes, because I collect books that nobody else wants, so I have a lot of shorthand books. That's a list of actual shorthand phrases, and that's what I mean by I didn't make it up. I read the poem Tuna and a Play about taking a walk with a friend and asking her. It's Jody Gladding. She's Jay, who's my friend, and we were walking, and I asked her, she likes the poem, but she says I stretched things a little bit. She didn't like that I had her face turning gray. She didn't like that. But it is absolutely true that when asked that question, she is the sort of person that we really have to think about. So there's two right there, concrete examples of what I mean when I say that they're all real. But you cited a totally imaginary piece. Absolutely. And you know what? There are a lot of those. There are a lot of those, too. You know, there are a lot of those. Yeah. So, a little bit of both. I guess I like to mix it all up. Yeah. Catherine.
I'm wondering what, you do a lot of treatments or erasures of old books. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering what got you started on that project, and what it is about that project that caused you to go back to it?
That project where I take white out and erase words from old books, to put it simply. I think they have a copy of A Little White Shadow over there. It's too hard to explain. If you just, really, the easiest way to understand erasure is to look at a page and you get it like that. You don't have any questions. So, what was the question? I'm addicted to it. It is the greatest, it's one of the greatest pleasures and joys of my life. I do it every morning first thing. And I don't write every morning. And when there's a period of time that I'm unable to do it, I crave it and miss it. And whatever, I don't know exactly what it is, but it's something about it suits me. I'm passionately love it. I've done 92 of those books. That's a lot, 92 of them. And I brought some and showed my students in class. I could tell at an instant they weren't really interested. Ah, oh, you're supposed to laugh. Orion, Natalia, Dan. But it's like writing. It's like writing. But I can answer it in this way. It's like a form. And I don't write in forms, in received forms. I never have, and I never will. I write free verse. End of story. I love poems written in form. I just don't. But erasure is a form. I get furious when people call it found poetry, because it's not. I mean, I work really hard, you know, on those pages. Someone doesn't come in and say, well, do this. But it's a form, and the form is this. Here's a pick. You know, when I write a poem, I have all the words in the English language to choose from, plus any that I might want to make up. In erasure, you have only the words on the page, and occasionally about six times per book, if I'm really desperate for a word I want to say something way cool, I can cut it out of another book and paste it in. You know, I did start doing that, but I only have the words on the page, so it's very challenging, and there's nothing like being frustrated by a page and getting mad at the page because it's not giving me enough to work with. But I had ways of dealing with that because there are many, because I can completely white out the whole page. And then I do a lot more image juxtaposition, so I glue a picture on it. And I have a little envelope called Mistakes Page. And in that envelope are all sorts of things to use if I make a mistake and an entire page has to be whited out. So I have a mistake. I also have a folder of, I don't know, 70 envelopes of images by category. I did a Journal of Nellie Walters was an erasure I did, and it's the entire book is the Journal of a Depressive. I mean, I turned it into that. It's a spiritual, uplifting, religious tract, but no. But the word suffering and death is on every page. And, you know, hopeless, because this it would be like things are not hopeless, but I could erase it and just say hopeless. So I turned this book into the Journals of Nellie Walters. And it gets darker and darker and darker and darker as you go, and she gets really, 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 it's a continuous narrative. And what was the point of telling you this? There was a point to it. Something about Nellie and that book. Oh, so my friend was looking at it, and he does erasure too. And all the images in that book are children being tortured, people, overly dramatic Victorian portraits of people, you know, people lying half dead over a rock, all these, and they're 19th century engravings. And he said, where did you get all these photos? And I didn't even think. They said, well, that was in the envelope marked torture. Because I have an envelope of torture pictures, you know. And, you know, so if I need, yeah. So it's a system now. It's like an artist in their studio, and there's a lot of junk. Yeah, I also get great lines that I end up in poems. I mean, I'll use a page that I like to begin a poem. One of the poems I read tonight, the first three or four stanzas is right out of an erasure. And then I had to finish it, of course, because in the book it wasn't finished. But thanks for asking. I hope that, yeah. And remind me to show you the books while I'm here. I don't usually travel with them, but I have to do this show in, up in somewhere else. So I have to. Yeah.
It occurs to me that the
Inky Flourish.
Inky Flourish is, maybe looks something like shorthand. And I'm wondering if the shorthand poem has shortened it. And
no, it does not. I see. That's not a bad idea. It's not a bad idea. I should have some shorthand in the shorthand poem, but I don't. But I totally, that's a wonderful idea, and I can absolutely see someone doing it. But the bottom line is we can't read shorthand. So, yeah, I see. It would be pricey, I think, for a press to do that. I mean, they have letters, but do you have shorthand on your... I don't know anything about it. Jason would know. I don't know. I like inky flourishes. What is a printer's word for that? You know, the little symbols that we use between stanzas or, you know, a little... Sometimes it's a little leaf that can be an asterisk. There must be a word, a printer's... I call them printer's marks. But there should be a word. We all know what we're talking about. And, yeah.
Would it be doodad?
A doodad? A doodad. It's hot. Go drink some cold water and get out in the cold night breeze. The warm weather's behind us.